Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2021. This morning we will continue our inquiry into baseline health protection measures with a specific focus on how these measures are working in the hospitality, business and leisure sectors. I'd like to welcome to the meeting Gavin Stevenson from Scottish Licensed Trade Association, Leon Thompson, the Executive Director of Scotland UK Hospitality, Barry McCulloch, Head of Policy for Federation of Small Businesses Scotland, Kirsty Cumming, Chief Executive of Community Leisure UK, Professor Irene Peterson, Professor of Epidemiology and Health Informatics, University College of London. Thank you for giving us your time this morning. This is a third of the four evidence sessions we have planned on baseline health protection measures. These measures are the main tools we are using to respond to the COVID-19, which include ventilation, face coverings, social distancing, and vaccinations. Each member will have approximately 12 minutes to speak to the panel to ask their questions. We're tight for time this morning and have a number of witnesses, so I would ask you please keep your responses as brief as possible and don't feel that you have to answer every question. I apologise in advance, however, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interests of brevity. I will now turn to questions, so if I may begin by asking the first question. As we move into winter and try to keep as many businesses open as possible, the committee has been looking at the baseline health protection measures such as ventilation when the committee heard from experts on the 4th of November. And I remember, Mr. Stevenson, when you were in our last committee, you told us in general, large nightclubs have good quality ventilation systems already in place. The Scottish Government has announced £25 million to improve ventilation and for CO2 monitors and reduce transmission for businesses. Firstly, I'd like to ask how well ventilated the premises are in leisure and hospitality sectors. And secondly, how many businesses currently have carbon monoxide monitors that you're aware of? And is this something that the industry is considering? If I could ask, first of all, Gavin Stevenson, please.
Thank you. In terms of the number of businesses that currently have carbon dioxide monitors, that's certainly not a statistic that we have tracked, but we'd be very happy to survey our members and come back to the committee with some more accurate information. With regards to the grants on ventilation, I mean, certainly 25 million is a very welcome support to the sector. And I would imagine that businesses are currently very much looking forward to that grant system opening, which I believe it does next week. I would note that the individual amounts are capped at £2,500 per application, which will certainly help in terms of things like adding perhaps additional vents or window openings. But certainly wouldn't be enough to install substantial mechanical ventilation systems. In terms of the current state of ventilation across the sector, broadly the larger premises tend to have very good mechanical ventilation, particularly larger nightclubs, because that has always been required for customer safety. Smaller premises, perhaps in listed buildings, may have less ability to install such large mechanical ventilation systems, but certainly would have a form of ventilation throughout the premises, because that's always been a requirement for customer safety. But I think anything we can do in terms of increasing that ventilation would be very welcomed by the sector.
Thank you very much. Could I move on to Leon Thompson from UK Hospitality for the same question, please?
Good morning. Yes, I mean, absolutely in line with Gavin. It's at this point, it's not possible to give you a figure on how many businesses have CO2 monitors, but certainly very happy to check that against or to check that with my membership. I would suggest that many more probably have them now than did have before, because ventilation has been a topic of discussion for a number of months now, certainly over the summer, and businesses have been getting ready for the winter and sort of looking at government advice which has been made available around improved ventilation. In terms of the ventilation scheme, which goes live next week or opens for applications next week, absolutely, you know, very welcome, and businesses will make good use of that. I think the only kind of caveat there is that this is an issue we've been talking about since the early part of the summer, so it is disappointing that the scheme is only going live now towards the end of November. And it varies from business to business in terms of the ventilation which is in place, as Gavin has said. But one thing I would draw to the committee's attention is the use of outdoor space, which hospitality businesses have made good use of over the last months when they've been open and trading. And certainly that's something we would like to see continue. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Can I bring in Kirsty coming from Community Leisure UK?
Thank you. Yes. I mean, I suppose similar to the previous two witnesses, we don't have a robust statistic in terms of CO2 monitors, but we do know through conversations with our members that it's certainly the vast majority of them do have CO2 monitoring in place. We also know that, you know, the Scottish Government guidance on CO2 monitoring has meant that a number of spaces across public leisure and culture have not been able to return to full capacity or have not indeed reopened. I think one of the main challenges across our membership is that the range of venues and buildings that they operate, you know, operating a number of heritage buildings, for example, a number of older venues, smaller spaces, where ventilation is inevitably more difficult and would require substantial upgrades. So that's, there's some spaces within our membership that have not yet reopened at all because of those issues. And as I said, some that have operating with reduced capacity. And then in terms of the Scottish Government's fund, which was announced at £25 million, I mean, obviously that is very welcome, but it specifically excludes our members. So none of our members would be eligible for that fund, as it does exclude ALIOs from applying for that fund. However, even if we removed the ALIO exclusion from that, the rateable value, you know, would certainly exclude the vast majority of our members as well. You know, and then it kind of would dig into the detail about the amounts of funding, you know, very small amounts for individual items, you know, very challenging for businesses within our sector to actually apply for in terms of going through the logistics of application for very small pots of funding. So there certainly is a challenge there. We also know that, you know, there's not a huge amount of funding available from any other sources for ventilation, so the cost is being picked up where that's needed by our members themselves or in partnership with their local authority partners. The other point, I guess, around ventilation that's coming through really strongly from our members is the enforcement of ventilation guidance at the moment. So there is clear guidance from Scottish Government. Our members are fully compliant with that, but there certainly is a feeling that that's not the case across all venues, both within the sector and, you know, in other sectors around ventilation. So it feels there's an enforcement issue there, which is leading to a bit of an unequal playing field.
Thank you. That's very informative. Can I ask the same question of Barry McCulloch from the Federation of Small Businesses Scotland?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. I would echo many of the comments made previously by panellists, and I would highlight the launch of the £25 million Business Ventilation Fund next week as a significant development, because there are clear market failures here around the ability of the most smallest business to make sure the property is properly ventilated during the winter months, given that they're not able to do what they have done during the spring and summer seasons. And I think whilst there has been that hiatus, as Leon mentioned, between the announcement of the fund in late September and the publication of the details this week, I think there are roughly three points that we would offer by way of initial reaction. Firstly, there's a lack of precision in who this fund is aimed at. You know, I mean, you go through the different types of businesses that could apply for the fund, and I think there are over 25 different types for a fund of £25 million. Second, there's a lack of clarity on how the applications and the appeals process will operate. There's a possibility, as we have seen during the crisis, of 32 different systems, 32 different appeal processes, which, as we know, can lead to businesses in one area receiving funds while another doesn't pay out. And lastly, and given what we may go on to talk about around the certification scheme, there's potential disappointment, I feel, for businesses given the likely high demand and the relatively small amounts available, you know, capped at £2,500 per eligible premises.
Thank you very much for your comments this morning. I'll just move on to Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you. Good morning, panel. I wonder if I could ask, maybe I'll start with Gavin Stevenson, about the announcement we had from the Scottish Government on Tuesday that they're considering an extension to the vaccine passport scheme that could potentially come into place from, if I remember rightly, the 4th of December, but we'll hear on Tuesday coming. So I wonder if I could ask you, first of all, what is your view on that? What impact would that have on your businesses were it to be introduced? And secondly, what sort of engagement have you had with Scottish Government ministers around this particular policy?
The five trade bodies in Scotland surveyed members last week to ascertain what the economic impact of the current version of vaccine passports had been, and it was little short of devastating for a substantial proportion of businesses. We have provided information to the committee in terms of the financial damage that has been done so far, but it would be, you know, typically between 20 and 40% of turnover has been the decrease from the month before vaccine passports were implemented to the month after vaccine passports were implemented. So there's a direct correlation there between the implementation of vaccine passports and a substantial and unsustainable decrease in trade. So any proposed extension of the scheme is deeply unwelcome from the sector. And of course, this is not particular to just Scotland. We've now got data from Wales, again, surveyed this week, showing that there has been a substantial decrease in trade in the Welsh sector as well. And indeed, similar reports internationally, which we've also provided excerpts of to the committee, showing that there were decreases in trade in France, in Canada, elsewhere after these schemes were implemented. So I think that if Scottish Government is determined to proceed with the rollout of the scheme, it would be absolutely essential to have significant financial support go in place for winter, because otherwise a very substantial proportion of businesses just will not survive this winter.
Thank you, Mr. Stevenson. And the second part of my question, can I ask you, what engagement have you had with Scottish ministers on this issue?
We have requested, the trade bodies have requested a meeting with the First Minister some 2 months ago, which we have received an acknowledgement of the request, but no meeting has yet been scheduled. We requested last week a meeting with the Deputy First Minister, and were told that he was unavailable. We do today have a meeting scheduled with Mr. McKee, and we will see what the outcome of that meeting is.
Thank you. Perhaps I could ask the same question to Mr. McCulloch next.
On Gavin's points, and I suppose notwithstanding the previous comments made by the Deputy First Minister regarding the possible expansion of the scheme to this committee, I do think it's fair to say that the statement made in the Chamber last week took many business owners by surprise. And whilst we and others had been monitoring the current scheme and the situation in Wales, I think what was surprising was the potentially large expansion under consideration to cover indoor hospitality and leisure settings. It led us, as it led other colleagues, to conduct a snap poll with over 600 members, revealing that 52% of businesses across the economy were opposed to this move, a notable finding in and of itself. But the story we were most interested in, and we've been talking to Scottish Government officials about, was the reaction from the businesses that could be potentially caught by the expanded scheme. And when you look at the response of just hospitality and leisure businesses, it will probably surprise you that opposition to an expanded scheme increased to 77%, with these businesses fearing that the scheme would lead to increased costs, reduced sales, and a considerable increase in antisocial behaviour. And just to circle back to your previous point, Mr. Fraser, we've been talking to Scottish Government officials really since the Deputy First Minister made that statement last week, and been putting forward their case to, I suppose, mitigate the impact on the smallest business.
Thank you. Perhaps I could ask Kirsty Cumming next.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, it's interesting to hear from the previous two witnesses, because obviously I'm coming from a slightly different perspective where we don't have vaccine passports within our membership at the moment or within our kind of sector. So interesting to hear from the experience of other sectors. But, you know, we've had a consultation, we've had a few conversations with our members around, you know, the possible expansion, what that would mean. And certainly there's significant concerns within our membership around the idea that it might be expanded across public leisure and culture. I guess to give some kind of detail on that, there's the logistical challenge in terms of how this could be implemented. You know, a lot of leisure centres particularly have what we call easy access gates, so no actual reception desk. So it would require, you know, additional staff that are not currently in post to be there to kind of staff and check passports. And that's against, you know, a backdrop of, you know, a recruitment crisis within the sector, where we're really currently struggling to recruit more, particularly front of house staff across leisure and culture. It's also the unaffordable angle of that, you know, against the backdrop of financial pressures. There's concerns around pressure on staffing, you know, particularly the mental well-being of staff. You know, due to the recruitment crisis that we have in the sector at the moment, there's already huge pressures on quite a number of staff across the country due to kind of staffing shortages, changed working patterns, and the whole COVID landscape, of course, behind that. So there's a concern that this would be an additional pressure. Also the risk of kind of potential antisocial behaviour from those that were opposed to it. One kind of key concern that's been raised as well is actually the kind of health risk. At the moment, our members are operating time slots, booking, etc., to try and ensure that there's no gathering of people outside of venues ahead of their activities. If we bring in COVID passports and that requires a checking process, there is quite a significant risk that will lead to queuing to get into venues, which is not currently there at the moment, or for people to be queuing outside of venues, particularly in winter months. And again, some real concerns around, you know, the customer base for our members. A lot of the customer base are, you know, older customers, people with underlying health conditions, long-term conditions that are using these facilities. So actually having another barrier to people being active, whether that's queuing or whether that's confusion over how to access a COVID passport. There's the risk of those that are digitally excluded, you know, and kind of having to bring paper passports, and also those that, you know, have additional support needs. For example, people living with dementia, there's a number of dementia friendly activities that take place. So again, this is seen as potentially being another barrier to that. And I guess the kind of final point is, you know, looking at where the COVID passport's currently in place, it's quite a different setting to, you know, what our members operate. You know, particularly if we look at, you know, the length of time that buildings are open, you know, so most of our members' venues are open, you know, up to 13 hours a day, 7 days a week, which is quite distinct to some of the other settings where COVID passports are currently being used. And again, the kind of staffing issues that go alongside that. But I guess just to kind of summarise, that, you know, the main concern really is the deterrent to people being active and the impact on their well-being by bringing in what's seen as another barrier.
Thank you. And lastly, Leon Thompson, please.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, you know, same thoughts as the other witnesses there. I mean, the announcement of possible expansion of the scheme has caused widespread alarm across hospitality. Hospitality businesses currently not in scope are very well aware of the impact it's having on the businesses that are in scope, and indeed some of them of those businesses are currently out of scope are experiencing some economic impacts as a result. In any case. I mean, issues around staffing, that's a big concern for our sector. Checking passports as people arrive, that's going to be a, major challenge. The timing of all of this is very difficult. Hospitality businesses are getting ready for what they hope will be a busy Christmas season if the expansion of the scheme does begin on the 6th of December, which is the date that's been given, then that has a potential to be pretty disastrous for businesses who maybe already have bookings in place, with people perhaps cancelling and other people not making bookings and deciding to have celebrations at home instead, rather than going out to the hospitality venues. So it's caused alarm, and I think quite rightly so, because as Gavin highlighted, from the findings from our joint survey, the impact of the scheme at the moment is having a detrimental impact on business.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in John Mason, please?
Thanks so much, convener, and maybe I could switch to Professor Peterson, if that's okay. The whole question of testing, she is there, yes. Good. And I have to say, the paper, I did have a look at the paper explaining why lateral flow testing may be relatively better now, or better than it was thought to be in comparison to PCR testing. However, it was quite a complex paper, I have to say. So I was just wondering if you could very briefly and in simple words for me kind of explain where you've got to with this.
Yes. So, yes, I do accept it's not a simple paper, but it's a very important paper because there have been a lot of doubt around lateral flow test when they were first introduced earlier this year. One of the key problem was that the lateral flow test was compared directly to PCR test without taking into account it is two different types of test. So when studies were made, it was like comparing apples and oranges. And it appeared from many studies that the lateral flow test had a very low sensitivity. So there were reports of a sensitivity of 40%, for example. The reason why this happened is because the PCR test is a test that tests for genetic material. And when you have COVID, you would keep having genetic material in your body for a long period after you have been infectious. So often when you take a sample of, let's say, 1,000 people, they may test positive on the PCR test, but probably more than half of them, if they have no symptoms, are not infectious. On the other hand, the lateral flow test is a test of infection. So it identifies the proteins from the virus. And therefore, it only tests positive in the period where you are infectious. And this paper illustrates that. So when you make a direct comparison between lateral flow test and PCR test, it may appear that the lateral flow test has a much lower sensitivity. But if you want to examine when people are infectious, the sensitivity of the lateral flow test is much higher, and we estimate it's certainly above 80% and possibly close to 95%.
Thank you. I mean, that's very it sounds very encouraging that we can put more reliance on the lateral flow tests. I mean, could we go as far as saying just forget about the PCR tests and just rely purely on the lateral flow tests?
For a public health measure, I would say yes. However, I think also, am I on? Yeah.
Yes.
I think the PCR test has a very important function in terms of you can sequence for new variants when you're using a PCR test. So I still think there's a place for PCR testing, but I wouldn't use PCR tests as a public health tool.
Well, that's great. Others may come back to you, but I appreciate that. Thanks very much. So maybe I could switch to Mr. Stevenson. and some of the things you've been saying about the vaccine passports and so on. I mean, I suppose my key question is, do you not think you've been slightly overstating your case and a certain amount of crying wolf, and people are not taking you seriously because you use such strong language like devastating and so on? Now, I mean, I've tried to get into a restaurant in Edinburgh on a Wednesday night and it was absolutely full. I've gone into a pub on a Wednesday night in Edinburgh, couldn't find a seat. Glasgow last Friday night, I was in a restaurant, absolutely full. So, I mean, parts of the hospitality and licensed trade sector seem to be doing absolutely fine. And, you know, I just wonder, do you not think you are somewhat exaggerating it? Similarly with the passports, I went into a COP event the other week, showed my passport, no problem, absolutely fine. So, and France seems, go to a cafe, go into a shop, show your passport, no problems. So do you not think you're overstating your case?
I think the challenge that we've got here is that all of the venues that you just mentioned are not currently required to use vaccination passports. So if you were able to get a seat in a busy restaurant, or indeed, you know, saw a busy pub, largely those are venues that do not currently have to use vaccine passports, and therefore would have substantially less impact from the current implementation of vaccine passports. If, on the other hand, you had read the, you know, the survey results that we've submitted, you'd find that all five of the Scottish trade bodies surveyed their members, and for those venues and those premises, there was a very significant decrease in trade. And you've mentioned there also the rollout in France. But, you know, the French National Federation of French Cinemas reported that they'd lost 7 million ticket sales in a month due to the implementation of COVID passports. And indeed, the French, one of the French hospitality trade bodies, reported that 80% of bars and cafes and 60% of restaurants saw their revenues drop by at least a fifth in the month after implementation of vaccine passports. We've had similar outcomes, of course, when they've been rolled out in Canada and in New York City. So, you know, this is not particularly a problem just in Scotland. This has been the experience, not just in Scotland, but elsewhere, that vaccine passports, when you put barriers between customers and businesses, that it results inevitably in a substantial loss of trade. Now, we've previously given evidence to this committee that businesses in our sector require turnover of 90% or so of normal levels to break even. So when you're reducing their turnover by 20%, 25%, 40%, there's clearly going to be a devastating impact that absolutely will affect the viability of these businesses.
Okay, thank you for that. Could I maybe switch to, let's go for Liam Thompson. I mean, the argument's been put before that if the vaccine passports are more widely used, people will be more familiar with them, both businesses and individuals, so they become the norm, which I still think has been the case in France from what I hear. One of my staff was there recently. Would you not think that would be perhaps the case that, and also if there was a negative test was part of the system, would you be more comfortable with it?
I mean, on the point about, you know, if it was the norm, it would be easier for people to use, people accept it more. I mean, that's kind of not what we're talking about. I mean, we're still talking about, you know, an expansion which targets, you know, hospitality. We're not sort of talking about sort of extending this scheme out to the rest of everyday life. So, I mean, there's still the burden is being put on hospitality businesses. I mean, hospitality businesses, you know, whilst they're, you know, continuing to prove their mettle in the face of a number of challenges, are still at least reporting a 10% decline in business on in the last quarter. So, if compared to 2019. So hospitality businesses are not in a strong position, are still very, very fragile. So anything which comes in which potentially damages that move towards recovery is unwelcome. Hospitality businesses have and continue to deploy baseline measures and go beyond baseline measures to keep staff and workers safe. So they are running very, very safe venues at the moment, and there's no evidence that's been provided so far by the Scottish Government that vaccine passports are making a difference to transmission rates, or that an expansion will make the kind of difference that that's being sought for the months ahead.
Yeah, so, thank you. Well, that's all.
Sorry, can I just bring in Professor Irene Peterson, who'd like to respond to that point? Thank you.
I will make a comment as a user of COVID passports. So this summer, I went to Denmark on holiday, and the COVID pass was widely used. Not one time did I find there was a problem in terms of getting into venues or in terms of staff having trouble in checking the COVID passport. And also at that time, my younger daughter was not fully vaccinated, so she had to have a test passport. But again, that worked out very well. And all venues we visited welcomed the passport because it gave the customers a safety of feeling of being more safe in the environment, as the chance of encountering somebody who had COVID was much lower in the venues. So I think, or I would suggest you take that into consideration when you evaluate the use of passport. I can fully appreciate that there might be some cost, but that's not up to me to comment on.
So that's very helpful indeed. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can we move on to Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Can I come to Kirsty Cumming first? And just obviously leisure, sort of community leisure is a particular interest of mine. And just ask, in the first instance, how you feel that the leisure industry has managed to adapt through this, the pandemic, and because it's my experience that they have been extremely good at delivering a safe environment. How do you feel that the leisure industry have fared?
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, I think from our perspective, it's the adaptation across our members has been phenomenal. Whether it's been the pivot to the digital, or whether it's been kind of adapting the new safety measures, the communications out to users of facilities. And I think we've seen really, really positive feedback from users of both the culture and leisure facilities right across our membership. I think one of the things that's been really kind of heartwarming is actually some of the feedback upon reopening as well. The real feedback showing how much people really value the opportunity to be active, to engage in culture, and actually just to socialise. Certainly the adaptation, it's been a journey, as I suppose it has for everyone. I mean, even dialing in here this morning kind of virtually, who thought we'd be here a couple of years ago. But yeah, I mean, our members have really kind of run with it. And I think there's an expectation as well, a learning process as to, what will actually change permanently going forward. We're not expecting to go back to exactly how things were. But, if we look at library services, as an example, there's been a huge uptake digitally and more people accessing library services than ever before. And that kind of digital availability of content has really made it much more accessible to a lot of people and been a bit of a lifeline through lockdown as well.
Thank you. I mean, my experience is obviously quite limited, and the only thing that I really see is the track. But the way they've adapted is that they've opened the gate and we're checked in externally. We don't go through the main building. So. And it's like an SAS operation. I think it's quite remarkable. I wonder what you feel the impact therefore would be on that kind of leisure facility, and you talk about libraries and et cetera, if the COVID passport is expanded into that area. Again, Kirsty Cumming, please.
Yes, I mean, I think, you know, as I touched on previously, the real concern is that it is going to just be an additional barrier. So those that really want to be active, those that are, you know, very comfortable with the passport, and that will be a lot of people, it's not necessarily going to, you know, hugely impact people using the facilities. But if we look at the return rates, so if we look at the return rates across leisure, specifically as an example, it's been increasing since the reopening, but it's kind of plateaued somewhere between 60 and 70% of pre-COVID levels right across our membership. Indeed, right across the sector and across the UK, the levels are fairly consistent in terms of that sort of 60 to 70% mark. What's interesting, I think, is looking at, you know, who has not returned, you know, and why they haven't returned to using facilities. And we don't have any concrete or robust evidence around that at the moment. But anecdotally, it's a lot of people that have more health concerns, a lot of people who are perhaps more vulnerable and have more anxiety around returning to, you know, public spaces and taking part in group activity. So there's a real kind of risk there that if we bring in COVID passports, and that is another kind of barrier, it's also the messaging that goes out as well. You know, if there's a COVID passport for some venues, whether that's across leisure or culture, you know, are those venues being seen as being less safe than other venues? Subliminal messaging that's going out to people, that's a real risk.
Thank you. Can I move on then? Just to move on from some of Murdo Fraser's questioning around the expansion of the vaccine passport and potentially what that could mean, I think we all recognise that we certainly need to take measures to restrict obviously COVID spreading. You're obviously against passport vaccine passports and the expansion of vaccine passports. Can I ask first to Barry McCulloch, What you feel should happen? What's your alternative options to that?
Thank you. I mean, my position in this debate is to represent the views of FSB members, Mr. Whittle, and so in that scenario is to put forward the evidence that we collected from over 600 members, which detailed their views on the introduction of the scheme and the impact. I think given where we are at the moment in terms of the potential scope of the scheme, I think we're very much focused on how you minimise the burden on the most smallest and potentially lowest risk settings. And I think there's a variety of options in that. But I think what we're trying to portray is the reality of how this scheme could function in neighbourhood cafes, country cafes, and what that would be like. And to try and explore through the context of the business regulatory impact assessment, the trade-off between the public health gain on the one hand and the economic impact on the other. And it's not at all to be alarming, but to have that grounded evidence-based conversation about what that scheme could look like. And I think conversations will continue to take place between government and trade bodies to try and arrive at that point. But I mean, as I said at the start, FSP members have made their views very clear in the sectors who could be within the scope of the scheme, and they would rather the scheme did not go ahead.
Thank you. I don't know if, is Gavin Stevenson got anything to add to that?
The sector is clearly very keen to work with government to try and minimise any of the adverse impacts from COVID. But equally, it would be naive, I think, to believe that if people are excluded from going into hospitality venues because they haven't got a COVID passport, or perhaps because they haven't been double vaccinated, it would be naive to think that those people are going to go home and put their pajamas on and watch television. You know, we have seen in previous waves of the pandemic, substantial increases in house parties and in gatherings in unregulated settings, where there will be significantly fewer baseline mitigations being enforced, where there may be worse ventilation, where you wouldn't have that regulated environment for people to gather in. So, you know, it was widely reported that Police Scotland broke up 44,000 house parties in the last phase of the pandemic. So, you know, it does seem to me that when 90% of the population is double vaccinated, high 80s of the adult population is double vaccinated, what is it that we're trying to achieve by implementing vaccine passports across all of hospitality? Because there is no evidence to suggest that the people who are excluded are not going to simply move to a less safe environment and continue mixing.
I'll give Leon Thompson the opportunity to respond if he has anything to add.
Yes, I'll probably just sort of focus on what businesses are already doing to keep their customers and workforce safe. I mean, even beyond the baseline measures of making sure that people are wearing face coverings and getting customers to use the check-in app. I mean, many businesses are still deploying a safety regime which goes beyond the baseline measures that came in at beyond level zero. So cleaning regimes, table service still continuing, one-way systems often still in place, increased distance between tables, which obviously means that there are fewer customers businesses can have in at any one time, investment in ventilation, we've talked a little bit about that, and similarly keeping Perspex screens in place as well. So businesses are already taking a lot of action to keep their customers safe, and there's no evidence that hospitality businesses have been responsible for significant spread of COVID.
Talking about a very, very quick one then, I just around the timing. Obviously, we're coming into a period of time when hospitality would get a fair proportion of their annual income, and the obviously the impact of introducing more stringent controls during that period of time, but the impact on things like time to plan, with staff and ordering supplies and rotas, etc. How quickly can you pivot under those circumstances? And I'll go to Barry McCulloch if I could.
Businesses have shown throughout this crisis that sometimes at the drop of a hat, within 2 days' notice, 3 days' notice, sometimes a little bit more, that they can quickly adapt their businesses and put in place measures that accord with their regulations. Should it be that way? Absolutely shouldn't, but I would absolutely highlight the versatility and adaptability of business owners, and that's been the way they've kept going throughout this crisis, and it will continue to be. I think what we want to see is a period of time where there is at least time to deliberate on the design of the scheme. So if the debate about the scope is complete or undertaken, then the discussion has to move very quickly to how we do it. And what does that look like? And what is the process? Are we checking the passes at the door? Are we checking on the inside? Is it related to bookings? Is it related to ordering? How does it work in businesses that have got multiple services, whether that's a hotel with a restaurant or a farm with a farm cafe? And I think that's where the conversation at the moment has to accelerate quite rapidly to give business owners the time to plan, because as you mentioned, Mr. Whittle, we're entering into a vital, busy trading period, and many of FSB members will be looking to make as much money during this period, because the January to February period is notably quieter. And I think whatever we decide, we have to take the business community with us, and we have to co-design this in whichever way we can to mitigate those pressures on the smallest business.
Have we got time to go to Leon Thompson?
So with Barry's point, I mean, businesses have shown themselves very adept at doing whatever is required of them, and I'm sure they'll be able to do that again if they need to. I think perhaps the biggest challenge in this is certainly the timescale and how that will play out with the public, because I think what we found with the the introduction of the scheme as it exists at the moment is that it took quite a long time for members of the public to get their QR codes sorted out and be in a position to start using them. We had what was termed a grace period as well, which was it was indicated this was for businesses, but really this was I think largely to do with the public getting used to vaccine passports as well. So given that we're moving into a critical time for hospitality businesses, Christmas trade and so on, if the public is not ready for this, then businesses will suffer.
Thank you. Can we move on to Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel, for attending. I have huge sympathy for the industry, I really do. I have worked in hospitality, I had a hospitality-style business, I've worked in the food and drink sector, I've still got a lot of friends and colleagues who are in it. And I've taken time to speak to a lot of them. And I've got to say, John's point to yourself, Gavin, and I certainly don't mean to pick on you, but what I'm getting back from them is, see, if we've got to do it, we'll do it because we'll stay open. And that's the biggest message that I've got coming back to me. If they have a concern, it's that they can't get enough staff. So if you're saying that businesses have to work at 90% of capacity in order to get a break-even point and keep going, there's a lot of these businesses are working at 70, 75% already because they cannot staff it. That's their biggest issue, is the one that I'm getting back to me. So I also pick up on the point that Brian made about this is a community effort to try and get on top of it. And we're very fortunate sitting here because we get evidence from right across medical, epidemiological. We're getting it from everywhere. And I get that your interests have got to look after your industry, but it is still a societal problem. And what we do know is that the age group that this was targeted at in order to bring the vaccine numbers up worked to a certain extent. So I'd be comfortable to see the passport vaccine extended because it makes the messaging a lot easier. Because one of the things that we've explored in here religiously has been how has the messaging gone out? So if people know between now and Christmas they're going to have that passport vaccine, they're going to get it. And to me, if that drives up vaccination, then it's worth it because your businesses will stay open, because if we don't and we go into another lockdown, everybody shuts. Gavin, I'm happy to argue with the point with you, so please come back to me.
There's a couple of things in there. We have surveyed hundreds of premises across Scotland in the last week and asked them some of these very specific questions. So 72% report that there's been a negative change in customer confidence and advance bookings since the launch of vaccine passport. Only 2% reported a positive change to confidence and advance bookings since the launch of vaccine passports. So this is based on, over 200 responses from across the hospitality sector, from a broad range of membership bases of the five trade bodies. So we can only report back to the committee what the members and what the businesses in hospitality are telling to us. With regards to your point about driving vaccination uptake, I think it's questionable if there has been any significant change to the trend of vaccination uptake in the 18 to 29 year old age group since the launch of vaccine passports. There was, of course, an uplift in second dose vaccination during that time period because there was a significant uplift in first dose vaccination several months earlier, and those people were now coming due for their second dose. But if you look at first dose vaccination rates, which is, in other words, reaching the vaccine hesitant or reaching the sector of those age groups that are resistant to vaccination, there doesn't really appear to have been any substantial uplift in the trend rate from before vaccine passports were announced until afterwards. And then finally, just to comment on the Christmas topic, there isn't time now for people to get vaccinated with two doses before Christmas. So, you know, if somebody chose today to get a first dose of vaccine, it would be 12 weeks from now until they were able to get their second dose, and therefore after that get their vaccine passport. And that takes us well past Christmas. So it doesn't seem it doesn't seem likely that the motivation will be there for people to go out today and get vaccinated if they haven't already been so, just purely to attend Christmas parties, or at least not Christmas parties this year.
Okay. I'm going to dispute your point that there hasn't been an uptick in the number of people, particularly in that age group that you mentioned, because we had the Deputy First Minister telling us that he can't give us a definitive, but you can't prove a negative. So I would argue that it has had the effect that I think that we're trying to achieve. Leon, what's your position?
I'd like to say on the point of staffing, I mean, that is a major challenge for our sector. And I'd like to highlight one of the things that came out from the survey that's been shared as well, and that is the extent of the abuse that's actually been heaped on staff working in hospitality over the last months. So respondents to the survey did, that was about 81% of businesses came back and said that verbal abuse levels had gone up against staff in their hospitality venues. And this has largely been driven because of staff shortages and customer frustration. So I would suggest that if staff have to check vaccination certification, that's going to create rise in likely hostility towards staff, particularly from people turning up who don't have certification with them or can't prove that they've been vaccinated. You know, the pressure will fall to individual members of staff and businesses to turn those potential customers away, which will just sort of increase conflict in hospitality settings. I mean, we all understand our civic responsibilities around ensuring people are vaccinated and taking all necessary steps to keep people safe. And as I've said, hospitality businesses have been very good at doing that and will continue to play their part in that. I think there needs to be stronger messaging to the public about being vaccinated and the responsibilities that we each have as a member of Scottish society. And I think that if we can get that right, and hospitality businesses can play their part in getting that message out there as well, then we can see the vaccination rates go up without resorting to an expansion of COVID passports.
Can I just say Barry McCulloch would like to come in on this point, if you can?
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I just wanted to build on those comments and stress that almost all businesses will accept additional public health measures if that's the alternative to a lockdown. Of course, we're on that. That emerged strongly from the discussions that we've been having with members since the announcement was made. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't fully scrutinise the additional measures, like the extension of the vaccine certification scheme, which is what we're doing here. And just to be clear as well, that we're not just talking about pubs and nightclubs. We're talking about capturing large parts of the everyday economy, from cafes, restaurants, gyms, personal trainers, and sport and entertainment venues like Crazy Golf. And our argument throughout all of this is simply about the economic and public health trade-offs. And if there is a trade-off, I think there may be a debate to be had. But I do also think that it's important to talk about the timing and the process points here, where we could have firmly evaluated the merits of this policy in the summer, but now we're designing and potentially implementing a scheme at breakneck speed ahead of a really key trading period. And I think that what the crisis has told us is that these types of initiatives, which are often hovering away in the background, they do cause a lot of uncertainty for business owners, even those who are not directly captured. And it's about trying to have those honest, candid conversations with business owners whilst giving them the reassurance that they can trade their way out of the crisis.
Okay. As I said right at the start, I genuinely have enormous sympathy for the sector, but I've also got absolute confidence, knowing the sector as I do, that it will be able to pivot and manage this. My biggest concern will be the fact that you can't staff it properly and you're increasing VAT come next year. That to me will be a much bigger issue than the vaccine passport being implemented. Could I come to Irene Petterson just now? How widely have you distributed your findings and how well is it being received?
So first of all, I apologise. There's building work going on, neighbour, but I will try to answer your question. So can you repeat, please?
Yeah. How widely have you distributed your paper and how well has it been received? And I'm specifically asking, and how is it actually going to be, if it's accepted, is it usable as a public health measure?
So the paper has been widely distributed in terms of the media. The day it was published, it was on the front page of BBC and Sky News and has been widely distributed. And in general, there is now a much more general acceptance that the lateral flow tests are much more sensitive than originally thought. So I don't know whether that answers your question sufficiently.
Do you think lead to it being a more usable public health measure?
I certainly hope so. That's the reason why we made the paper, because we were aware of all the negative publicity the test had at the beginning. But I often think when you introduce new tools, it takes time before people accept the tools and understand how important they are. I think actually the lateral flow test are one of the most important tools we have to keep control of COVID, apart from the vaccines, of course. But as you had experienced, for example, in the previous week from Glasgow, you could see that it is a very helpful tool in terms of giving you a rapid answer and also identifying people who are infectious.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you. Can we move on to Alex Rowley, please?
Thank you, and good morning. In terms of abuse of staff, I noticed I phoned my GP practice this week, and interestingly, the GP was there with automated message making clear that if anybody was continuing to be abusive to the staff, then they would be removed from the practice. And therefore, that level of abuse towards staff, frontline staff, is not something that's just particular to your industry. And I would suggest that actually what you need to be, the message that needs to go out is if people are abusive, they wouldn't be welcome in the pub, the restaurant, whatever it is, in the first place. And that's the danger I see with what I've heard this morning. You know, you say, Gavin, that government's putting up a barrier between customers and businesses, but me going on and pulling up my certificate, I would hardly call that a barrier. And so maybe if we can move on for the negativities. And by the way, the numbers of vaccination amongst young people has gone up and did go up since the proof of vaccine was introduced. The issue is that you cannot necessarily claim that was as a direct result of the proof of vaccine being. But again, you're wrong to say it's not gone up. So we need to take the sort of wild herons out of the equation here and start talking about what needs to actually happen. So can I ask on that note, Is it your view, and is it the view of the industry, that as well as proof of vaccine, it would be also helpful, as Northern Ireland did yesterday, for example, where they've introduced much more stringent measures than we have here so far, the proof of negative test? Do you have a view on that, and do you think it would add something to the need to prove that you're safe to go into these venues? Gavin, do you want to kick off maybe?
Sure. So, you know, I think just to clarify there, we didn't say that there had been no increase in first dose vaccination in the 18 to 29 year old age group during the course of the rollout. What we said is that there had been no significant increase to the trend in first dose vaccination during the rollout. So, you know, we have provided in the evidence packet that we sent into your committee a trend line that is Public Health Scotland data on vaccination. And, you know, if you can point to me where there's a significant increase around the launch of vaccination certification, I would be grateful because we certainly can't see it having looked for it. In terms of the negative testing, so, you know, when we look at the barriers that are being put between businesses and their customers, you know, there are two key issues here. So the first one is that a proportion of customers, and it's a very small proportion overall, but it is much more focused for places like nightclubs, a proportion of customers will not be double vaccinated. Now, obviously, they cannot get a vaccine passport, therefore they cannot get into a premises. That's clearly a barrier. In terms of the adding the option of negative lateral flow tests, then that would certainly remove that barrier if a customer could either prove that they were double vaccinated or prove that they had a recent negative lateral flow test and therefore gain admission. So that would be a helpful and welcome addition to the scheme if there was an option to add lateral flow testing for those customers that could not prove double vaccination. Does that clarify? I think, sorry, yeah, that, just also to finish on that point, just to finish, sorry. Take up of the vaccine passports is also an issue. And we've been asking for data from Scottish Government for a number of weeks now as to how many unique users in Scotland actually have taken up the offer of a vaccine passport. And government has been unable to provide that information to us, albeit they have noted that there are perhaps you know, a million and a half or so downloads of the app, and then some additional downloads of paper copies, but they may in fact be the same people or substantively the same people that have the app. If there's only, you know, 30% of the Scottish population that have a vaccine passport, then clearly that would be a barrier to the two-thirds that haven't yet managed to obtain a vaccine passport from the government.
Okay, I think we're tight for time, so can I ask the other members of the panel, maybe start with Barry, specifically on the question of the negative proof being added to what is already in place in terms of the proof of vaccine certificate?
Given I have zero expertise on this issue, Mr. Riley, I will not contribute to this point, and I will perhaps leave it to experts such as Professor Peterson to provide the committee with an informed view.
Okay. Any other members of the panel specifically on whether the proof of vaccine, sorry, the proof of negative test should be included with the proof of vaccine certificate? Professor Patterson?
Yeah, I think it would increase the uptake of the COVID pass if you allowed to include a recent negative test, for example, within 72 hours. Some people may decide to go and get the vaccine because it makes life a lot easier. But on the other hand, you should also allow people to get entry if they can prove that they have a negative test. And I'm aware that is a part of the Danish COVID pass, and also they allow people who have had a recent infection a COVID pass.
Okay, thank you. Kirsty?
I mean, similar to Barry, I don't have a huge amount of expertise in this area, but one thing that is worth mentioning is just in terms of the planning and pre-booking for events. You know, so if we look at, for example, on the cultural side of our membership, things like theatre, performance, pantomimes obviously being the kind of topical one that's coming up. People book tickets, you know, months in advance for, you know, attending these events. So, you know, there is a consideration there as well around, you know, those that don't have, you know, those that are not vaccinated for whatever reason, but have already, you know, kind of paid for tickets to events. So, you know, there's perhaps a consideration around lateral flow testing as an alternative to allow people entry.
Thank you. And Leon?
Briefly, I mean, certainly some members have reported that if a negative lateral flow test could be used as an alternative, then that would help their businesses, and they'd be turning away fewer people from the door at the moment.
Yeah, thank you. I certainly spoke with pantomime theatres this week, and pantomimes came up, and that very point came up. So, Barry, you've not got a view on the negative test, but can I ask, you know, has this Federation of Small Businesses put forward any proposals where they believe that the government could support small businesses if this rollout actually takes place?
Yeah, I mean that's a key point. That if you go back to March 2020 and consecutive interventions in public health, there's been the other side of the coin, which has been direct financial support. And I think that where we took it down this path, then I think that relationship between public health interventions on the one hand and public financial support delivered by the Scottish Government on the other would have to be part of that equation. Because I think as previous panellists have said and others have made clear, that it will potentially dampen trade. And that's something that is coming through our evidence and discussions with members. And I think there is a definite conversation to have about how you alleviate that impact, especially for the unlicensed trade who do not have door staff, who have very little experience of schemes like this. And I think her point with government officials will always be about the practical operation of any scheme. And how we get it right. And I think the crisis has also shown us that sometimes we don't always get it right at the first go, and we constantly need to keep it under review. And I think that's maintaining openness to ideas whilst also providing support to businesses is, I think, quite a key element when we're talking about these measures, Mr. Rowley.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think we all appreciate how challenging it is for the industry at the moment. We've just got a little bit of time, so if I may just ask one more question. Looking at barriers for businesses at the moment, I'd like to know the witnesses' views on the impact of leisure and hospitality, particularly in town centres and city centres, and also in the local communities, on the continual shift for home working. So could I please ask Leon Thompson, first of all?
Thank you. Yes, I mean that's having an ongoing impact. I mean, city centre hospitality business particularly badly impacted by the working from home message. It's very hard for them to really move forward until, you know, there's reasonable footfall again, sort of during the week and in the daytime. It also sort of spills out into the evenings as well, because if people aren't in offices and other workplaces, then nobody's going out straight from work. We've talked about Christmas as well, has an impact on Christmas too. There's certainly going to be sort of fewer staff parties, work get-togethers and so on, and certainly members are reporting that they've got very few bookings for Christmas events, work-related Christmas events. They are hoping that they might see the bounce of in those numbers, particularly around sort of the unofficial Christmas parties, if you like. But at the moment, it's not a good picture that's coming from city centre hospitality venues and businesses.
Thank you. Can I ask Barry McCulloch for his views on it?
it's impossible to not have this discussion about the health and well-being of our city centres and our town centres without linking it to where we were before the crisis, where actually there were many, many local places that were still struggling with the crisis of 2008, or indeed the crisis in the late 1980s or 1990s. And I think that what we've seen is that there is a balance in our membership between those who have been directly affected by the loss of commuter traffic and commuter spends and the likes of city centre leisure and hospitality. But there's also been those businesses who have found the benefits and efficiencies from working from home. And I think that what the Scottish Government's town centre review, which I took part in for FSB, tried to do was trying to find that balance between increasing the economic benefits for local neighbourhoods, where there's lots of small businesses who've done pretty well because the spend that has not taken place in our city centres has been taking place elsewhere, albeit much of that online. We was trying to provide targeted measures to our city centre businesses who are really struggling. And what we're seeing on top of that, to complicate matters further, is a real structural shift in the economy with increased digitisation and mass transport habits changing in terms of how people get to work or go to work. And I think at this point, and it's coming through from the evidence that we are seeing it and others, it's really difficult to disentangle the impact between the pandemic and other structural shifts, particularly for independent retailers. And it is that group that, whilst you didn't ask about the community retailers, convener, it is that group that we have got considerable concerns about, particularly in places like Edinburgh and Glasgow, who do rely not just on local people using their facilities and services, but they also rely quite enormously on foreign travellers coming to the country and spending money. And I think that how this all goes together and creates a degree of uncertainty is something that concerns us. And I think that as we move forward throughout the pandemic, the Scottish Government and others will obviously need to channel quite substantial sums of money into our city centres and towns to allow them to regenerate and regroup given the pandemic's impact.
Thank you very much. Can I bring in Gavin Stevenson, please?
Absolutely. No, I would completely agree with the previous comments from colleagues. There's been a substantial impact on hospitality businesses from the decrease in footfall in town and city centres as a result of home working. And, you know, it's just another of the impacts that the sector is having to deal with at the moment, on top of other barriers to trade and impacts that will no doubt continue for some time to come.
Thank you very much. Can I just lastly ask Kirsty on the leisure aspect, please?
Thank you. I mean, I suppose it's slightly different in the leisure perspective. A lot of leisure, you know, sports centres are not traditionally in town centres, but we have certainly seen an impact on, you know, usage patterns. You know, people that would traditionally kind of commute use kind of leisure facilities before or after work, or use facilities in a different kind of geographical area to where they live as well. So there's certainly been an impact from that perspective. The other impact that we've seen is around, you know, the footfall, as previous speakers mentioned, in town centres. You know, so if we look at the footfall for museums and galleries, you know, cultural attractions, that's been significantly down, whether that's, you know, as a result of home working or it's a result of people being, you know, not wanting to go into city centres or kind of the general landscape. You know, we couldn't draw any conclusions from that other than, I suppose, anecdotally, we know that there is significant reduced footfall for these venues.
Thanks very much. Can I ask members if anyone's got any other questions for our witnesses today? Jim Fairley?
I've got one very brief one, and that is the first person. You said about businesses should allow the use of lateral flow tests or a proof of a negative test. My only concern about that is, how do you stop people cheating? Sorry, you're on mute.
Can I be unmuted, please?
You're unmuted.
Yep. Yeah.
Okay, yeah, that's a good question. At the moment, we have a system in UK where you are self-testing, and you may continue with that, or you may decide to have test centers operating for this purpose. So you could have a two-arm testing approach. People can test at home, but if they want a negative lateral flow test, they may have to go to a test center to have it performed, maybe one option. Or you may say, okay, we are going to trust people that they have a photograph of the lateral flow test and that is submitted for approval. I think there are different options you can choose.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank all the witnesses for their evidence and for giving us their time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you about how to do this. Thank you. I'm just going to move into private now. Thank you. Good morning. We'll now move on to agenda item number 2. The committee will take evidence from the Scottish Government on the latest ministerial statement on COVID-19 and subordinate legislation. I welcome to the meeting our witnesses from the Scottish Government, John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, Dominic Munro, Director of COVID-19 Exit Strategy, and Elizabeth Sadler, Deputy Director of COVID Ready Society, Scottish Government. Welcome. Thank you for your attendance this morning, and thank you also for your letter providing further information on vaccine certification monitoring information following your last appearance at the committee, and also for the letter that we received yesterday regarding long COVID and children. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move on to questions?
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to make some opening remarks to the committee, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to discuss a number of matters, including updates to Parliament this week and last week on COVID-19. As set out in the recent ministerial statements to Parliament, we continue to face a very serious position in relation to the management of the pandemic. Cases are at a very high level, having increased by 10% in the last 7 days. The NHS is under sustained pressure, and we can see from a range of other European countries the gravity of the ongoing situation that a number of countries face, of which we are one. We do also continue to make good progress with the vaccination programme, and the rollout is continuing at considerable pace. Reflecting on the COP26 summit, the rigorous measures put in place to try to reduce the risk of COVID transmission, including the requirement for daily testing, seem to have been effective. As the First Minister set out on Tuesday, we have reached the latest three-weekly review point for the remaining COVID regulations. As announced, the Cabinet agreed to keep the current regulations in place with no immediate changes, although we also discussed the possibility of future changes to the COVID certification scheme. As the First Minister outlined, based on current and projected vaccination uptake rates, we are assessing over the next few days whether we should amend the current certification scheme by considering the scope of the scheme and the role of lateral flow tests within the scheme. No decisions have been taken yet, but the settings who could come under the scheme in future are indoor cinemas, theatres and some hospitality settings. We would, of course, retain exemptions for those under 18, for those who cannot be vaccinated or tested for medical reasons, for people on clinical trials, and for those who work at events or in venues subject to the scheme. Exceptions would also be retained for worship, weddings, funerals, and related gatherings. We intend to take a final decision next Tuesday in light of the most up-to-date data. In the meantime, we will publish an evidence paper tomorrow. We are consulting businesses on the practicalities of implementation should changes be made. Certification continues to play a role in helping us to increase vaccine uptake, to reduce the risk of transmission of coronavirus, to alleviate pressure on our health and care services, and to allow higher risk settings to continue to operate as an alternative to more restrictive measures such as capacity limits, early closing times or closure. Finally, an updated strategic framework was published on Tuesday. We updated it so that we are as prepared as we can be to manage foreseeable pressures as well as the real risk of increasing COVID-19 cases as we enter winter. Our strategic intent remains appropriate in guiding our response to suppress the virus to a level consistent with alleviating its harms while we recover and rebuild for a better future. And I'm very happy to answer the committee's questions.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. If I could turn to questions now, and I've got just two, and the first one's very brief. I know that all members have been inundated with emails regarding a campaign, so I just would like to have clarity from the Scottish Government. Is the Scottish Government planning to implement vaccination passports for children?
No.
Thank you. Moving on to the next question. I wonder if you've had the chance to consider the evidence we have heard last week about the role of ventilation in high-risk medical settings, such as dentistry. We heard about the significant backlog of 4 million appointments which were lost due to the pandemic. It is clear that ventilation has a big role to play in recovering those lost appointments. The British Dental Association told us that dentists need to use fallow time between patients to make their settings safe. The fallow time can be as low as 10 minutes with good high-speed suction equipment, but the time needed between appointments can sometimes be as long as 50 minutes, which there isn't time available. The BDA estimated that the current funding to improve the ventilation works out around 1,500 per surgery. But in their experience, upgrading ventilation can sometimes cost between $15,000 to $20,000. Is this something the Scottish Government will give further consideration to?
Yes. There are obviously some real challenges here. And I'll bring in Professor Leach here, who is, whose professional career is in this professional training is in this in this area. But there are obviously some very real issues about the potential for spread of the virus, given the procedures that are being followed within dental practices. I have to say that dental practices have adapted formidably to the challenges that they face, even with that adaptation, there are still real pressures in relation to accessing dental services because of the amount of time that is required to be left between appointments for the type of hygiene process to which you refer, convener. We will continue to engage with the BDA and with relevant interested parties on this question, because the role of ventilation is significant, and there may well be further practical steps we can take to assist. Now, a lot of practices will have a lot of very sophisticated processes and equipment available to them. I certainly recognise that the dental surgeries I attend nowadays are in marked contrast to those I attended in the past. So there has been very significant enhancements, but there is a necessity for us to ensure that we work with the sector to boost the practical support that's available, in addition to the financial support we've already made available to support ventilation improvements. I don't know if Professor Leach wants to add.
Yeah, but you've covered it well, Deputy First Minister. It's an excellent question. Dentistry is just about the hardest piece of the health service to make COVID safe, because of the aerosols we generate when we drill. It's as simple as that. That's the blunt truth. The other elements of dentistry are not any more high risk than other close-up contact outpatients, like physiotherapy or other things that you would do to the head and neck. But the aerosols you generate from the air, water and drilling, that's the problem. So that wasn't fully understood 2 years ago, because it couldn't be. Now, as we've moved and the world has gathered, in fact, Scotland has led the way, there is an evidence-based paper that gets updated all the time from Dundee University, led by a colleague of mine, and that has gone to all the chief dental officers in the world in order to adapt the way Scotland has adapted. And we will have to continue to adapt and adapt again. It's not just ventilation, it's also the type of drills that are used. You can change the suction at the drill tip rather than in the room. There's lots of technological things that we can do, and then it's a matter of educating the broad dental teams about how that works. 50-minute fallow time is now, I think, a thing of the past, but fallow time is not. So fallow time is allowing the dust to settle, clean the dust, next patient. That's why you have that fallow time. Rather than it being in the air, you give it time for it to fall onto the surfaces. You can then clean it away. That's what that's about. And ventilation is one of those solutions. It might be helpful if you had either saw oral evidence from the chief dental officer, or even a letter from the chief dental officer, I think, would fill in some of those gaps for you. I know, and I should reiterate what the Deputy First Minister said, the teams who are quite close to me, I go out for dinner with them, they're my pals, they've worked really hard to make this as safe and as fast as they can.
Thank you. Appreciate your comments. Meadow Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'd like to ask a couple of questions that have come up in evidence we've heard today. The first came to a comment, which actually was in private session, from our committee advisor, Professor Peter Donnelly, who told us that there's been a 20% rise in excess deaths compared to what we would normally expect at this time of year. And that cannot be explained by an increase in the COVID rates. And he said that this is an issue that needed urgent consideration. In his view, this is down to pathologies and diseases which are going undetected and untreated, including, for example, later stage cancers. So I wonder if you agree that this is really a serious issue, and if so, what has been done to try and better understand why it's happening and what should be done to address it?
I think it is a serious issue, and I think it relates directly to some of the difficult judgments the government has made in reconciling the challenges of dealing with COVID with the wider challenges that COVID, the dealing with COVID presents to the rest of society. So the development of the Four Harms framework was last summer, summer 2020, an explicit recognition of the very legitimate issue that Mr. Fraser raises, that there is the direct health harm of COVID, which I would acknowledge was the central focus of government decision-making between February-March 2020 and the summer of 2020 when we adopted the Four Harms framework. And then the other three harms of non-COVID health harm, economic and social harm. And that was a recognition by the government that we couldn't just deal with COVID alone. We had to make sure that other factors and other conditions were being addressed. I think there is obviously a whole programme of activity that has been in place to ensure that there was as little interruption as possible to some of the routine services that would perhaps identify some of the conditions to which Mr. Fraser refers, and to ensure the recovery of health services to enable them to be addressed. But the points that Professor Donnelly raises merit further investigation and analysis, which the government is and will be continuing to do, to ensure that we have the proper and correct balance between measures to tackle COVID and measures to tackle the wider health harms that members of the public will face. And I think that dilemma, I think, gets to the heart and influences some of the decisions that we make about the overall, you know, what do we as a whole society have to do to tackle the issues that are thrown up by COVID. So it is a serious issue, and it's one the government is looking at with care.
It's an excellent point Dr. Donnelly makes. It's three things, and anybody who asserts that they know what it is probably wrong. We don't know yet what it is, but it is three categories. It's COVID, it's postponed care by health services around the world, and it's postponed care by people for whatever reason they didn't come forward. Either they're scared of COVID, scared of bothering us, scared of whatever it might be. There's an excellent website called Euromomo, M-O-M-O, and Scotland participates in Euromomo, and Euromomo is where we measure excess mortality for the continent. So it is a continental problem. It's about those numbers, 10, 15, 20% in all major European economies. And we won't truly understand what that is until those people are through the system. We have actual diagnoses and actual outcomes. Some of it will be undiagnosed or late diagnosed cancer, for sure. Some of it will be COVID. Some of it will be respiratory disease on top of respiratory disease that already existed. And it is a consequence of a global pandemic. I fear that it will also be happening in countries where we don't know, where we simply don't have the COVID rates or the other disease monitoring that we have across Europe. But it's a phenomenon that we absolutely have to tackle. And my colleagues in the health service are dealing with the consequences of it every day.
Thank you. That's very helpful answers. I know my colleague Jim Fairley would like to pursue some of this in due course, and I'm sure it's an issue the committee will want to return to because it is so significant. Can I ask a separate question around the issue of vaccine passports and the consideration that the Scottish Government is giving to potentially extending these? And I'm not going to get into rehearsing all the arguments for and against because we've debated those before and we'll debate those again, but I wanted to ask a specific issue that's come up in terms of evidence this morning, which is the potential for extending these vaccine passports to either other hospitality groups or to, for example, theatres. We know that there are people currently who will have made bookings for Christmas parties, Christmas office lunches, people who made bookings for the theatre, for the panto season as a family. I know our family have done that. People tend to book these things well ahead. If these premises are brought under the remit of the vaccine passport system and people have not been vaccinated at this point, there will not be time for them to get vaccinated prior to Christmas. So they therefore will be looking presumably to cancel their bookings and get money back. So that will be a significant challenge for theatre operators, for the hospitality trade. So does the Scottish Government recognise that challenge? And if it goes down this route, does it also recognise that these businesses legitimately would be looking for substantial financial compensation to make up for that loss of income.
I recognise the issue, and it's one of the practical issues that we are considering as part of the points that we are addressing in relation to the potential expansion and extension of the scheme. So these are legitimate points to consider. I think what I would say in trying to put this into context is that we do have, in general, very high levels of vaccination within the country. So the position is such that the overwhelming majority of the population are double vaccinated, because as I said earlier on, any consideration we would be exempting children. So in the case of the Panto season, children would not be covered by this. But obviously, in different age groups, particularly in the 18 to 29-year-old age group, we have a lower level of vaccination compared to older age groups. And as you go higher up the age groups, we have really very, very strong levels of vaccination. So the number of cases that might be affected by this, because of those high levels of vaccination, I don't think substantiates the severity of the question that Mr. Fraser puts to me, or the volume involved in the question that Mr. Fraser puts to me. There would undoubtedly be some people that would be affected, but because of the high vaccination rates, I don't think it would merit some of the characterisation of size of the problem that Mr. Fraser raises. What I am satisfied about is that access to the vaccine certificate is pretty straightforward. You know, the system's working well. People are able to download their vaccine certificates. There are occasional cases where people's data's not correct. I've furnished the committee with more detail on that point, which Mr. Fraser and I exchanged comments about at the last time I was at committee. So there are, in amongst 10 million or so vaccinations, issues with about 7,000 that are currently outstanding and being resolved, which is a very small proportion. Matters to those 7,000 people, but it's a small proportion. So these are all issues that we are considering as part of the practicalities that we're involved in.
If I can just ask one follow-up to that, Deputy First Minister, I'm still getting communication from constituents, I'm sure you are too, who are people who cannot still get vaccine certification via the app. These are people either because they were part of trials and have not been able to, the app is not able to provide that certification, or people who have been vaccinated in other jurisdictions, perhaps overseas, and again, the app does not permit them to produce that certification. So they're concerned that if the vaccine passport scheme is rolled out further, that puts them at a disadvantage. So what is being done to make sure people in these categories can get the certification that they need?
I think I'd want to separate the two categories in there. On the question of people in vaccine trials, their circumstances should be addressed by the measures that we've taken. If there are people who still do not have that, I would happily engage with members of Parliament or individuals to try to resolve those issues, because there should be, their circumstances should be really pretty clear because of the arrangements we have put in place. There are examples where people have been vaccinated in other jurisdictions, and I'm seeing a number of cases in that respect, both within my own constituency and more widely. And individuals should seek the help of the helpline to provide assistance to resolve those issues. And as I say, we are working through all of those cases to try to enable there to be a solution in place for some individuals. There will be some issues around some vaccines that are not MHRA approved, which is slightly more challenging, but that I would expect that to be at the extreme end of the spectrum. They are more challenging to resolve, but nonetheless, we will endeavour to resolve them.
Thank you. I'll move on to Alex Riley, but can I just remind members and the witnesses that we're a bit short of time today, so if we could stick to about 8 minutes for questions and answers. Thank you. Alex Riley.
Thank you. In terms of where Murdo finished off there, if I can pick up on that, because you've got quite a number of people. I've been surprised by the number of people that have contacted my office where they've had vaccines abroad, where they've been working abroad. I also, sadly, had a lady I talked to the other day who's been told medically she can't get the vaccine, and she also feels this is probably her last Christmas, and she wants to go out to places. So there are those cases where proof of a negative test would change that situation for those people. Northern Ireland, I saw yesterday, have agreed a much wider rollout than the government here has of the proof of vaccine certificate, but also have included in that, as has most of Europe, the proof of a negative test. And so that's what I want to come on to, because whilst I didn't hear Mr. Swinney on the radio yesterday, I'm being told that he seemed to suggest that both the negative test and the vaccine certificate would be required if there was going to be a further rollout. I wonder, can you say to us what the thinking of government is around this, what evidence that you're looking at in terms of including proof of a negative test?
I think the first point I'd say is in relation to the circumstances that Mr. Riley puts to me about the lady who's, for medical reasons, can't obtain the vaccination. In terms of the arrangements, she should be able to obtain certification that enables to demonstrate that that is the case. So there should be no impediment to that lady being able to access documentation that would allow her to essentially operate as if she had vaccine certification. So that, on the wider question that Mr. Riley puts to me, the point I was making on radio yesterday morning is that there is a spectrum of public health interventions that we can undertake in relation to the use of vaccine certification and other evidence, if I could put it that way. At one end of the spectrum, you've got what I would call the belt and braces approach, which would be vaccine certification and a lateral flow test. So that would be demonstrating that people had been double vaccinated and they also had undertaken an LFD test, which would provide assurance that at that moment, because as we know, one can still be double vaccinated and contract coronavirus, that they were not in that position. So that's the sort of belt and braces end of the spectrum. At the other end of the spectrum, it would be, a LFD test only option. So the point I was trying to get across is that there are a range of choices that can be considered on that spectrum. And in amongst them, there is vaccine certification or the alternative of LFD test, LFD evidence, or as Northern Ireland have actually applied a third, which is demonstration of recent infection recognition of having had coronavirus and therefore having antibodies. So there's a range of options that are available there, and obviously the government is giving consideration to those options, as I've confirmed to the committee before.
Mr. Swinney will accept that. I mean, this is not the normal way to do legislation. We continually pass SSIs in here that were in force previously. It's not ideal, but certainly I, for one, have said that party politics and try to score political points should be put to one side. We are in a crisis and everyone should be behind the government and trying to get forward. But the quid pro quo for that is that we have complete transparency in terms of the thinking. And if you bring forward next Tuesday proposals to expand this without including whatever European country, which your colleagues in Wales and Ireland have done, then I do think you will need to explain that, and we do need transparency. We need to understand, whilst making laws in a way that is not the norm and does not give you full transparency, we need to understand better for the government what it's thinking as. So I don't think it's just good enough to say, well, we'll make that decision next Tuesday and we'll announce it.
Well, I think what I'd say to Mr. Rowley is that, well, first of all, I think he puts to me a completely reasonable point, so I don't dispute that. But what I would say in response is that I think these issues are all being aired by the government. You know, we set out some weeks ago, back in early September, although we aired away back in probably April, I would think, the first possibility of vaccine certification. You know, we've aired the evidence, we've aired some of the options. I'm here today to engage in that conversation. I appreciate this is where, as a minister who's having to wrestle with this situation, I am grateful to Parliament. Parliament has been very pragmatic about the legislative approach we've got to take to deal with a situation that is changing around about us. And the government, frankly, couldn't bring forward the necessary legislation in the fashion that we would all like to be able to do. We'll have the normal processes of scrutiny. But what we're trying to do is to be as open as possible, airing these issues, responding to the issues raised by members. And that's either in the format of this discussion here at committee or in the statements that are made by either the First Minister or myself or the Health Secretary in the updates that we've made in recent weeks and also in wider debate. So I do give Mr. Rowley the assurance that, and we will also be providing an update to the evidence base to inform a wider audience about the issues that are preying on the government's minds and that we're wrestling with as we come to these conclusions.
Okay, thank you. And can I finally, there's an article in The Guardian this morning where it's for the health editor, Andrew Gregory, and it says mass wearing cuts COVID incidence by 53%, says global study. Basically what they're saying is results from more than 30 studies from around the world were analysed in detail, showing statistically significant 53% reduction in incidences of COVID with mass wearing and 25% reduction for physical distancing. I've raised this before, but I'm concerned. I mean, this week I've been in a number of shops where particularly, I would say, the younger generation, but parents, young parents, etc., not wearing masks, face coverings. The shop itself that I was in one shop I was in anyway, had these tannoy announcements every so often saying you should wear a mask. If the evidence, if this piece in The Guardian today is right and the evidence shows that mask wearing is having such an impact on trying to allow us to live with this virus, then I think the government needs to look at enforcement. You know, there's no point in introducing further baseline measures where one of the strongest measures is not being enforced. You know, the government, I know you've said that the cabinet have discussed this, but where are you satisfied with the levels of enforcement, or should you be looking at other steps to ensure enforcement of face coverings in shops, etc.?
I think I saw the material that to which Mr. Rowley refers. It's a very substantial academic paper which was published in the British Medical Journal on the subject of media reporting this morning, and it looks at a range of different surveys and research exercises that have been undertaken that internationally that prove on a compelling basis the merits and value of face coverings and of being an obstacle to spread the virus and physical distancing. So in terms of the decision making of the government, having taken the step to ensure that we maintain the position on face coverings that we have maintained, I'm glad that we took that decision. I think Mr. Rowley puts a fair challenge to me about whether or not that is being applied as much. The research evidence we gather demonstrates, I think it would be fair to say, a declining level of compliance with those routine measures. But what these studies show in a compelling way is these routine habitual elements of protection would actually help us to avoid having to do other things. So if we all want to avoid the other things that we all want to avoid, the other restrictions, disciplined use of face coverings would actually help us formidably in that challenge. So what follows from that is the question about whether there is a necessity for us to take a more stringent approach, which puts much greater regulatory force into these arguments, and that's obviously part of the agenda that the government is considering. Now, when we looked at these issues at Cabinet last week, we took decisions, you know, we could have taken a decision at Cabinet last week to relax even the restrictions we have in place or the requirements about face coverings. We didn't do that. You know, the advice that I gave to Cabinet was that the assessment of the current state of the pandemic merited no relaxation of the measures. We agreed to come back next week to consider whether we need to extend them further. And the points that Mr. Rowley raises are issues that we'll consider.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Jim Fairley, please.
Thank you, Convener. Murdo Fraser earlier on spoke about some of the evidence that we took this morning and the 20% that we can't of the excess deaths that we now have. And that's talking in a generic way about what's happening nationally. I want to talk about one person. I have a constituent who is younger than me by some number of years. She's a mother of four. She has cancer. She's had one operation. She's been through chemotherapy. And she is now, last week, she was taken to Ninewells, prepped for surgery. And she was in the day before, and she came to 9 o'clock the following morning, and her operation was cancelled because there was no ICU bed. She contacted me in some distress because she is fearful of her life. She has been told that she needs this operation. If she doesn't get it, she's not going to make it. So you can understand the concern of her family and everybody else about it. And I think we need to sometimes just remember that that's what it's about. It's about these individuals. So we were told this morning that ICU beds are blocked for longer by people who are in with COVID. We've also been told that all of the people who are in ICU are people who are unjagged, who haven't had the vaccination. And I know that we've got the, you know, we're doing all the things that we're doing, but what can we do now to get her a bed?
Well, the first thing I'd say is that the circumstances that Mr. Fairley recounts are deeply regrettable. But I'm afraid the burdens that are being wrestled with on the health service make examples like that a possible consequence of the pressures that we are facing in the National Health Service. Because we are in a situation where the National Health Service at every level is under enormous pressure. There are urgent questions in Parliament on a fairly regular basis about the pressures on particular health board facilities because of the pressures on the health service. Now, if there are individuals who require intensive care support, we have to be satisfied that capacity is available for them, whether they are coming into hospital for an operation that is pre-planned, as in the case of Mr. Fairley's constituent, or where there's been an immediate emergency where somebody requires intensive care support and it couldn't have been predicted. So we're having to plan for those two circumstances. Now, ICU occupancy on the 17th of November yesterday was 73. Now, that was down from 79 a week before. Now, that will be spread across the country. And the overall position on hospital occupancy is a slightly better position than it was a week ago. But what we... The solution to this challenge is to try to reduce the burden that COVID is placing on the National Health Service. That's the solution for Mr. Fairley's constituent, which is why the government is taking the measures we're taking to tackle the wider challenges around about COVID. Now, I'll ask Professor Leach just to comment on the point about occupancy or length of occupancy in ICU beds in relation to COVID, because there will be a variation in the length of stay of COVID patients in hospital, depending on, for simplicity's sake, age and wider health context of those individuals. But the fundamentally, the challenge that we face is about reconciling the need to deal with the impact of COVID and the need to protect, to address the other health conditions that members of the public will face, which is the point that Murdo Fraser put to me at the start of this session.
So the first thing, Mr. Fairley, is clearly to express my sympathy to that family's situation. I'm certain that my colleagues in TESA will do everything they can to correct that, and I imagine they're doing that today and tomorrow. If that doesn't get resolved, then please feel free to get in touch and we'll try and we'll see what we can do. There's some context here, which Deputy First Minister has begun. There are 277 people in intensive care today in Scotland, 277 for all diseases. Our baseline intensive care capacity was about 200 before COVID arrived. So we didn't have 277 beds before COVID. Now we've got 277 people in beds in intensive care, fully staffed with doctors, nurses, care teams in those intensive care units. COVID has changed the game globally. It's a new disease and we haven't taken anything away. No disease has disappeared. And therefore we've had to adapt, and we've had to adapt really quickly, whether we're in Austria or Scotland. And the intensive care teams have had to change the way their buildings work, change the way their staffing works. They've had to change everything. And that, of course, therefore, has led to just exactly the same answer as I gave Mr. Fraser earlier. There's a backlog of people who have had conventional care that's carried on. There's a backlog of people who have been scared to come forward. I would just make two further comments. The beds are not blocked by people in intensive care. They're being treated in intensive care, and they're in the right bed. Yeah. We don't put them there for no reason.
Yeah, I accept
that. And we let them out of intensive care as quick as we can, because it's not a good place to be for them or their families. So we want them out, and there will be beds downstream for them to move to, because intensive care is so high in terms of demand that we need them. The other thing is, actually, length of stay increasing, ironically, is something to celebrate, because, forgive the shorthand, the patients are not dying as quickly. So we have learned so much about this disease that we can save lives better. And that's one of the reasons why the death rate is so much lower now than it was in the first and the second waves, is intensive care teams now have more drugs and ammunition at their disposal to keep people alive. But that means they stay longer and they survive. So that's fantastic, but there's a consequence to that. And that means you're in bed for longer. So about 16 COVID cases have been in intensive care for longer than a month. Now, there's every likelihood they will have a good outcome. Not all of them, but some of them will have a good outcome. And that means that bed is full for over a month. And it means it's not available for a stroke patient or a cancer patient during that time. But that's to be celebrated, because we're able to keep those people alive and they will walk out of hospital subsequently. So it's a very complex system of clinicians, of drugs, of patients and families. But in its core, it's about your constituent. It's about that lady and her family. And we need to make it as good as we can for her and for everybody else this system touches.
OK, I can confirm I have written to the Chief Executive, and if her next date is cancelled, I will be on the phone. At-home boosters. We are being inundated with people who cannot get out and are requiring a booster jag. They're going to 7, 8, 9 months since their last second jag, and there seems to be a disconnect between GP surgeries and the healthcare system putting the two together. We're getting positions where people aren't even on the system. So there's something wrong somewhere, and it'd be possible to find out what the problem is so that these elderly patients can get back out in society.
Obviously, in terms of the way in which we've opted to, and this varies to some extent around the country, but health boards have looked at the scale of the challenge to roll out the booster vaccination programme, and indeed the performance has been quite extraordinary. Yesterday there were in excess of 65,000 vaccinations undertaken in Scotland, and that's now a pretty routine figure for a daily basis between flu and the booster jag. Obviously, there is a range of different models being used, from larger centres, smaller facilities in smaller communities, but then also a degree of distribution at very local level in individual homes or care homes to those who cannot access other centres. So that programme is being pursued and rolled out. I would give the assurance that everybody that needs to be covered will be covered by that programme. But obviously, it may well take slightly longer to get round a volume of home visits at the same time as we are taking forward large volume of the distribution of the vaccine. But I'm certainly very happy to explore further what additional steps can be taken to address the issue that Mr. Fairley raises, to ensure that individuals are receiving the vaccination when they require it.
Sorry, I don't have time, but might come back to you. Brian Whittle, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I'm minded that this committee is called COVID Recovery Committee, so we're trying to look ahead, kind of how we get out of this particular crisis. So I want to return to the stat that Murdo Fraser raised earlier on, that there's 20% more deaths than expected that are now no longer explained by COVID, and the impact that's going to have going down the line. And I think the example I would like to use is around MSK and chronic pain, and we know that, for example, having a knee replacement or a hip replacement significantly improves the health and well-being of that individual, and then negates the need to continue medical attention while they have that issue, if that means so, and the deterioration in mental health, etc. So, and there is a mortality associated with that, not treating that kind of condition. We've already heard about cancer as well, and one of the things that was said this morning by Peter Donnelly was that we're not collecting the data around things like a cancer stage shift when it's first being diagnosed, and it's going. There are diseases that are going under-investigated and under-treated. So the balancing act here, which I completely understand from the government, is around focusing on COVID as opposed to other conditions. But to my mind, I think there's a pressure on the health service just now. Are we storing up future pressures on our health service and creating another crisis that's going to cut? It's inevitably coming down the track.
I want to helpfully engage with Mr. Whittle's question, but I want to push back on just one bit of the terminology that was used there, where Mr. Whittle suggested that the government was focusing on COVID rather than other health conditions. I would reject that as a characterisation of what the government is doing. What the government is trying to do, and it really relates to my answer to Mr. Fraser earlier on, we are trying to wrestle with all of the health challenges that we face as a country. Some of them are about COVID, some of them are about other factors. What I accepted in my answer to Mr. Fraser is that some of the other conditions that have always been with us, are still with us, and will be with us tomorrow, are attracting less attention and capacity within the health service, because the health service is also having to deal with COVID. So that's my kind of pushback on the characterisation. We're trying to deal with everything, but COVID presents an extra volume of activity. And Professor Leach's response to Mr. Fairley about ICU, in a sense, makes this point. We had 200 ICU beds before COVID. We've now got 270. But we've got 70-odd of them occupied by COVID patients. So we've expanded the capacity of the health service beyond what we would normally have, but that extra capacity has been taken up all by COVID. Now, I think there is underlying Mr. Whittle's question is, I think, a fair and reasonable observation, which is that the longer what one might call routine procedures, such as a knee replacement or a hip replacement, are delayed for an individual, the greater their recovery is from the weakness and challenges they may be facing just now. So somebody who's finding it difficult to be mobile because they've got problem because they need a new hip, that's just going to get more acute and more challenging the longer they've got to wait for a hip replacement. And obviously, if they've got a hip replacement, having a father who's had a hip replacement, the difference in his mobility pre and post is colossal. He's had years and years of extra ability to scoot about, which has been good for him in every respect. So I think that's the fundamental problem, but we don't have an easy answer to it because the COVID condition has got to be addressed and the other cases have got to be addressed, and then you will have examples like Mr. Fairley's, which are life-threatening, and we have to make sure that they have got priority over some other conditions which will be enormously painful for individuals, but they won't be immediately life-threatening, which the case that Mr. Fairley raises will be.
Thank you. Given that you've pushed back, you'll not be surprised I'm going to push back against you, Secretary, in that this was raised by Peter Donnelly. It's the unexplained 20% more than expected deaths that are the concerning. And I'm looking at stats here that say that the number of patients waiting to be seen for eight key diagnostic tests are 30% higher than they were for the 12-month average back in 2019-2020. So I'm back to this point again. I totally recognise, Cabinet Secretary, the need for the government to balance. What I'm starting to question is, are we getting that balance right? And as Peter Donnelly said, the diseases are being under-investigated and undertreated, and the data is not being collected. So basically what I'm asking here is there a potential for the government to start collecting more data around this, because there is a crisis coming down the road at some point?
I would have thought that the data collection issue is appropriate, but I'll take that point away, and I'll take further advice from my from health officials, unless Professor Leach wants to add anything to my comments. But I'll look at that. I would have thought data collection would give us information, because, for example, we will know from existing data the number of patients who are considered requiring particular treatments. Let's just concentrate on hip replacements. We will know how many patients are waiting for hip replacements who've been referred through the system. We will know how long they are waiting. We will know how much longer they are waiting than they would have waited pre-COVID. So data like that will exist, but I'll explore the points that Mr. Whittle raises with me. I think the question fundamentally comes down to, and this is where he and I are in agreement, is around about balance. How much of the resource of the health service is required to support people with COVID, how much of it is required, not just to support people with COVID, but then to do other things associated with COVID. So for us to be able to vaccinate 65,000 people on a daily basis, we need trained clinical staff to be, crudely, not in a hospital, but in a village hall. And we need them to transfer to do that, because vaccination is going to be an important bulwark against the virus. But if clinical staff are delivering vaccinations, they're not delivering the other healthcare that we might want them to deliver in another setting. So what we are trying to do is to maximise the resources that are available to ensure that all health conditions are adequately met and addressed. But I would have to accept that places increased strain on the existing health services and the way in which they operate. And the consequences for that for patients are that they may well have to wait longer for treatment to be received.
very briefly, if Mr. Donnelly, if there's specific data Mr. Donnelly wants, then I'll do my best to get him. Peter and I know each other relatively well. I'm not sure which gap he specifically refers to. If it's initial diagnosis cancer stage data, you can't get that until you see the patient. That can't be on the waiting list. Most people, there isn't a cancer waiting list. Most people referred for cancer, cancer's not mentioned in their letter. They come with pain, they come with lumps and bumps, so you can't know. That subsequent diagnostic data and then outcome data only happens as the disease progresses and the treatment progresses. So that is available. It's a slightly more research version of that data. We do know who's waiting. We know in some senses what disease they have, so it might be a sore hip or a sore knee. In many cases, we don't know what's wrong with them, and they're waiting in order to get a diagnosis for what's wrong with them. But I'm happy to look for what data Dr. Donnelly wants. I might be slightly more forceful than Mr. Swinney, which is unusual, but I'm not sure what you want me to stop. So if you think the balance is wrong, then I'll have to stop something. So I come to this committee and you tell me to accelerate vaccines, do more testing, treat the backlog. There has to be balance in there somewhere. I've just spent 3 days in the Western Isles and I've seen astonishing healthcare in really quite difficult environments. Vaccines in the backs of hotels, a mobile testing unit in the car park, and the hospital still doing absolutely everything it can to provide the healthcare to that population. So we have a new disease. We're having to manage that new disease and manage all the old disease.
Just so I can clarify what's being asked by Mr. Peter Donnelly.
We have
cancer
to move on
stage
to
shift.
John Mason, please.
Thanks, convener. I think just three questions, if I may. We had quite a useful email from the British Society for Immunology with some figures in it. One of them was if somebody's been vaccinated, they're 32 times less likely to die than if they haven't been vaccinated, and also that the two doses of vaccine give between 92 and 96% protection against hospitalisation. I think these are quite strong figures. Yeah. Are they ones that we recognise?
Yes.
That's good. Thank you. That was one down. Secondly, if we're going to roll out the vaccine certificates further, there's both the issue of people actually having had the JAGs, but there's also the issue of people not having access to the certificates. And for example, I think I have the largest bingo place in the UK in my constituency, and they're saying that 40% of bingo customers do not have access to smartphone technology. So I'm wondering, would it be possible just to send a paper copy of everyone's vaccine certificate to them?
Well, for vast numbers of the population, that would be, frankly, a waste of resources because they've got access to the smartphone technology. A paper copy of a vaccine certificate is only a phone call away for individuals, literally a phone call away, and they'll have it sent in the post. If there was to be, I'm very confident that systems, we were giving a notional 14-day turnaround time for paper certificates, but they were generally arriving in 2 to 3 days. So it's the capacity is there to deliver certificates to those who require them if they are required in a paper form.
Right. Okay. And thirdly, we had evidence early from Professor Peterson that we could put more reliance on the lateral flow tests than we maybe have been. So I just wondered what your thinking on that was.
There is the material on the assessment is that we operate, and I listened with care to Professor Peterson's evidence this morning, which I found very interesting indeed. The evidence that we rely upon is that the lateral flow test is more than 80% effective at detecting any level of COVID-19 infection and likely to be more than 90% effective at detecting the most infectious people at the point of testing. So there is a strong and high reliability in lateral flow testing. And that is why we encourage people to use lateral flow tests and to do so on a regular basis, because it introduces an element of opportunity for individuals before they're going into wider settings to assess themselves, are they potentially a carrier of the virus, and then putting others in danger of contracting the virus. So there is a strong evidence base that supports the use of lateral flow devices. Obviously, the primary purpose of the COVID booster, the COVID vaccination certificate scheme, has been to boost vaccine uptake. Obviously, the use of lateral flow device tests has a wider application, and that's obviously one of the material issues that we're considering.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think up till now we have put quite a lot more emphasis on or trust in the PCR tests. So I just wonder if her studies kind of bring the two more into balance.
I thought actually Professor Peterson's answer to you on that question, I thought explained why there is the necessity for both.
Yes.
That the lateral flow test is a routine, regular, safety first type of assessment. The PCR test gives us the ability to be absolutely certain, to be able to draw clinical data out of that test to provide us with information about the development of the virus. And of course, we know that to be significant from the issues that we're wrestling with the Delta variant, which has had such a profound impact on the prevalence of the virus in Scotland.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Mason. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item, and I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for their evidence today. Now move on to the third agenda item, which is consideration of the motions on the made affirmative instruments and the draft affirmative instruments considered during the previous agenda item. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any further remarks on the SSIs before we take the motions?
I'm in your hands, Convener. I'd be happy to give an explanation of what is before the committee, if that would be helpful, but I also don't want to hold the committee.
Sure. Thank you. Would any members like... No? Everybody happy? Thank you. Are we agreed to move en bloc? We're agreed to move en bloc. I now invite the Deputy First Minister to move en bloc motions S6M-01688, S6M-01885, S6M-01886 and S6M-01918.
Moved en bloc, Convener.
Thank you. Would any members like to make any comments? I know no member has indicated they wish to speak, so I'll now put the question on the motions. The question is that motions S6M-01688, S6M-01885, S6M-01886 and S6M-01918 be agreed. Do members agree? Thank you. The motions are agreed. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the statutory instruments considered at this meeting in due course. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Deputy First Minister. I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his supporting officials for their attendance this morning. The committee's next meeting will be on the 25th of November, when we will take evidence on baseline health protection measures. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and for the meeting to move into the private section. Thank you.